Lord, by your word, teach us. By your spirit, ingrain it in us. And by your love for us, educate us. In the name of Jesus, amen. So, Mark chapter 10, verse 32. We're getting through Mark, don't panic. It's occasion in a preacher's life that they look at something, they think, how much longer, Lord? And then you realize about 6-7 more chapters to go. Mark chapter 10, verse 32 to 52. Now, if you remember last week, I had to cut down the sermon on 139 down to 20 minutes because of the excellent being led in worship, etc., by Belinda's son-in-law, Deji. Do you remember that? That was really good, and I had to cut down my teaching by 20 minutes. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Okay, you haven't got that opportunity today. Now, you may recall, or you may not recall, a couple of weeks ago, it was the discussion over divorce and marriage, or remarriage, yes? Jesus blessing the children. Remember that? And I skipped over the young rich ruler teaching because of Boller's most birthday boy last week who tried to avoid it. Excellent teaching on the young rich ruler, which I thought, well, you don't need me to recount all over that again. And if you may recall, I said all three accounts, Mark is trying to show us something about discipleship, about being with Jesus, behavior in marriage. Before you all turned up during the practice this morning, there was an interesting debate about marriage, and I was told to discipline my wife, and then somebody turned around and said, I don't see that in the Bible, and then we talked about Ephesians 5, and it was an incredible debate. I won't stitch the people up, but needless to say, the person who wanted me to discipline my wife was sufficiently disciplined themselves by other members of the worship team. So, as I said to the other person, have you met my wife? I have no intention of wanting to discipline her. Behaviour in marriage, behaviour with children, how we should look at children and treat them, and Jesus was blessing them, and where in his society children were not to be seen at all, let alone heard, but he treated them completely differently. He said, no, hang on a minute, society needs to be turned on its head here, and blessing them. And clearly the young rich ruler is about our discipleship with possessions, or that's one of the key messages in that story. So we're now moving forward into the next section, where we see discipleship very starkly, what it is and what it is not. So you up for that?
Yeah.
Oh, good. I know I'm the one with the microphone, but I think collectively we'll be all right. So let's start with verse 32 to 34. They were now on their way up to Jerusalem. Notice that phrase, up, which is an interesting phrase. True, Jerusalem is higher than Jericho, where they end up being, but actually there is this sense of going up, because it is the capital. Up, that's where the temple is. Up is that sense of we are going up to. How many people turn around and say, oh, well, we're going up to London? If you came outside of London, we're going up to London because it's the capital. Now, if you're from down south, it makes logical sense. But some people from up north go, we're going down to London. You have it wrong. I don't care geographically, you're wrong, all right? So don't even go there, you northerner. You got it wrong. No, I'm joking. But it's geographical. There is an element here of geographic that it is above sea level, above Jericho in that respect. But it also is the up is because it is the place where God is, as far as they're concerned, within the temple. Do you get the point, yeah? So it's just something Mark's trying to show us. Up, you know, I'm reading the Bible, aren't I? Yes. There they were now on the way up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. I want you to really note that. Jesus was walking ahead of them. The disciples were filled with awe, and the people following behind were overwhelmed with fear. Just want to talk about that just for a minute. Because it clearly is more than just the 12 disciples with Jesus. There is other people as well who are following and with Jesus. And also, therefore, the crowd following are much bigger than we give. We always talk about the disciples, the 12, which is right. But it's clearly a lot more people with Jesus wanting to know. There is confusion over that particular verse. What does it actually mean? Was it everybody was fearful? Was it just the people following and the disciples were just in awe? Let's not worry about that. Let's just take the fact there's a whole bigger group of people with Jesus. So the people following behind were overwhelmed with fear. Taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus once more began to describe everything that was about to happen to him. Listen, he said, we're going up to Jerusalem, where the Son of Man, where Jesus, you know, titles himself the Son of Man, will be betrayed to the leading priests and the teachers of religious law. They will sentence him to die and hand him over to the Romans. They will mock him, spit on him, flog him with a whip, and kill him. But after 3 days, he will rise again. Just want to allow verse 34 to sit in. I'll reread it again. They will mock him, spit on him, flog him with a whip, and kill him. But after 3 days, he will rise again. So the disciples were filled with awe. In the NLT version, awe has that meaning of surprise and fear. It's one of those weird terms of phrase. It both means surprise and fear. Just a sideline, I think we've turned the word awe into wonderment. Funny enough, Andy has no idea what I was speaking on this morning, but I thought of that song, Lord, you are awesome, so awesome. And I don't know about you, maybe it's just me, but I get a sense that sometimes I go, oh yeah, Lord, you're just awesome, wow, you're amazing, you're fantastic. We miss the fear bit out. It's really a bit of, God, you are so surprising and you are to be reverently feared. Now, it doesn't mean we are being petrified, scared of him, but we do have to recognise that God is not our buddy, buddy, buddy. He is other. He is holy. We do need to recognise he's all-powerful, all-awesome. There is something in the fact that he is all-powerful, all-holy, all other than us, that in our worship we sometimes have to recognise he's not our buddy, buddy, buddy. Does that make sense? With buddy, buddy, buddies, you can be a little bit, yeah, sorry, I can't make it tonight. I'll cancel going down the pub with you, yeah? God, you can't quite play fast and loose with. There is an element of needing to be, yeah, actually, you're somebody to be feared as well. Not petrified, not scared, not to the point where you can't enter his throne room of grace, which he has opened the door, flung wide for us to enter into. But we do have to recognize he is completely and utterly other. Anyway, the disciples were awed. Well, this is the third prediction time by Jesus that he's going to die. In Mark, there's three of them, and this is the final third one. And this is the one where it really defines about how it's going to happen. So there must be at this point, why are the disciples filled with awe? Why are the other people afraid? Well, they must now know after the last two times, oh my life, this is it. We are going to a place where he has said he is going to die. What does that mean for us? What does that mean for us? There must be that element. Imagine yourself on that journey. You know now you're heading towards Jerusalem. I mean, Jerusalem itself was a scary place if you was a Jew, to be honest with you. There was lots of reasons why, especially if you came from the outer country. But you know that Jesus said, actually, when we get there, I'm going to die. not the sort of place that you want to go into knowing that something bad's going to happen, is it? Would you not be scared if you know you're going to a place that's dangerous?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So let's just take that for a minute. So they're scared. And they're probably thinking, what does that mean for us? I want us to note something about Jesus. Right at the beginning, I said Jesus was walking ahead of them. Now, I don't know about you lot, but when I know I'm about to go into a situation that I really, really don't want to go into, it's not going to be what I consider a pleasant situation. It may not be a pleasant meeting. Yeah? It might not be somebody I'm going to have to meet with someone that I really particularly maybe not want to meet to because it could not go very well. Now, I don't know about you, but there are times. Maybe it's even like going to a hospital for a hospital appointment. You know this may not go well for you. So do you walk in with that? Yes! Looking forward to this. Let's go. No. Who tends to walk in with a track? Don't want to get there too early. I want to get there on time, but let's take me time getting there, yeah? Who's like that? Yeah, we're all like that. Come on, let's be honest. Okay? So if you know you're with a crowd of people and you're going to a place you really want to go to, you sort of drag your heel, then you hang around chatting to them for a bit. Let some others go ahead of you for a minute. Yeah? I sometimes have this habit of sometimes saying, but if I'm going to a place I don't know, and I don't know the layout of the building particularly, and I don't particularly want to just walk bowling in there, I sometimes go, oh, well, I'll be after you. Yeah? I don't sometimes like going into unknown places particularly. I like somebody else to go in first. If darts are suddenly going to shoot out and hit them, I have Raiders of the Lost Ark type moments in my head. You know, let them cop it first. I can't be, no, I'm joking.
Nice.
Yeah, I know, yeah. Joy's really good for that. But you know what, sometimes you do, don't you? Drag, you don't want to. So, or let somebody else go in first and you try and take your time. But here we have Jesus, knowing he knows what's going to happen to him, leads the way. He goes ahead of everybody else. He doesn't drag his heels. In Isaiah, the phrasing is, he sets his face like flint. Sticks out his chin, in my case, about three of them, but sticks out his chin and says, I am going ahead. This is a place of suffering. I know it, but I'm going to go into it. And you lot better follow on behind. Now, that's an imagery of Jesus. I think sometimes we miss about him. We hear about the Jesus, meek and mild. Not a word did he say when he was being accused. So you have this imagery from Renaissance pictures with him like this. But this is a mini image of Jesus, face like flint. Gonna go for it. Let's go. That's the place that God's calling me to go to. That's where I'm gonna suffer, and I'm on the off. Do you like that imagery? I like that imagery. Here's a rhetorical question for you to think about for a moment. How do you feel when you're about to go and set into a place of suffering? That's a rhetorical question. I don't want anybody to confess anything. Just think, how, when you know you're about to go into a place of suffering, be it a meeting, let's just say for a minute, how do you really react internally? Think about that now, just for a minute, for yourself. Okay, here's the next thing. Jesus knew that what he was doing was for God. This suffering was for the Lord. And not just for the Lord, but those people who were following him. And for the whole of the world, the whole of creation, all that. He had the bigger picture in mind in his walking towards Jerusalem. Recognizing he's going to suffering. So here's for you. And here's for me, that question, What am I like when I know I'm doing something for God because there's a bigger picture involved? It will be for others in the room, not for me. What? And I know I'm going to suffer because of it, but it is for God. It is for others in the room. How do I really react to that? What is your reaction to that? Think about it. It's a rhetorical question. I want you to reflect for yourself for a minute. They will mock him, spit on him, flog him with a whip and kill him. But after 3 days, he will rise again. There's a TV program on Prime TV called Outlander that Joy and I have enjoyed watching. There's certain things we have to fast forward through because it's content that really, as a Christian, I'd rather not be watching. So, but there's a scene there where one of the main characters, you see him being whipped about 100 times, if my memory serves correctly. Now, I know it's all make-believe, but it's done well enough that you sit there with that sense of, whoa. Then you see the repaired scars on his back afterwards. Very well done. And I remember watching that, and all I could think of was Jesus. Actually, both Joy and I was watching it. All we could think of was Jesus. I know The Passion of the Christ has done it really well years ago, but in that particular moment, I was watching that, all I could think of was Jesus, just taking that suffering and not giving in. And yet he set his face like flint and led the pack to that suffering. And we're asked to be Christ-like. So let's look at two disciples' way of responding to that last statement of Jesus. But after 3 days, he will rise again. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, or the sons of thunder, came over and spoke to him. So he's just declared that he's going to be mocked, spat on, flogged, killed, okay, and risen again in 3 days. So James and John go, Jesus, teacher. By the way, the fact they used the word teacher was meaning that they were trying to be reverent, but really, teacher? And we're going to ask you something that really we know we shouldn't really be asking. We want you to do us a favour. Sorry. It's like going up to someone, excuse me, mate, why don't you do us a favour? You're all right, could you just do us a favour? Is that... But you want us to do us a favour. What is your request? He asked. They replied, when you sit on your glorious throne, we want to sit in places of honour next to you. One on your right and the other on your left. Now, we giggle and laugh at the moment as I'm the way I'm telling it, because I'm telling it with a sense of, really? This is what, you've just heard this, and you've gone over to Jesus and said, by the way, can we sit in places of honour on your right and on your left when you sit on your throne? Because we still believe in power. But Jesus said to them, you don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I am about to drink? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering I must be baptized with? Oh, yes, they replied, we're able. Then Jesus told them, you will indeed drink from my bitter cup and be baptized with my baptism of suffering. Now, some people at this point think that this is Jesus predicting that they will be martyred in the same similar way that Jesus was in a similar way. There's no real evidence of that. I think it's more talking about the fact that you are just going to suffer for following me. But, you know, it is what it is. But I have no right to say who will sit on my right or my left. God has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen. Let's just leave it at that just for a second. Oh, actually, no, I've got to finish it off because it makes sense. Hang on. When the 10 other disciples heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. So Jesus called them all together and said, "You know that the rulers in this world lord it over with their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must be the slave to everyone else. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many." For me, James and John, all they heard the words of Jesus was, "I will rise again. I will rise again. I will be glorified. I will be in authority." They clearly recognized that Jesus meant he'll be in authority. But all they heard was the, "and I will rise again." They missed all the suffering bit before. And so they had the audacity, and I will state, the audacity to request this. Now, there's an element that you can understand. There is an element that you can understand. Because James and John were with Peter on the Mount of Transfiguration, were they not? Yes? So they've had an amazing moment with Jesus. An amazing moment of seeing Moses and Elijah. An amazing moment of encountering Yahweh in a way they never would have expected to have done so. Isn't that amazing? Wouldn't you be thinking, "Yo, we're special. Yo, we're special." Woo! Yeah? But I love the fact that the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, is actually, Mark is scribing Peter's memories. Oh, Peter was up on that mountain as well, wasn't he? So I can imagine that as Peter's recounting this to Mark, that maybe there's a bit of a sense of, right, let me point out what these self-centered Watsits were thinking. Yeah? I mean, there was no sense of, "And what about Peter, Lord?" It was sorting ourselves out, right and left. Oh, so self-centered. They had no sense of caring for the others. It was a case of looking after one's self. So what do you think? What should, this is a real question. I've given a few easy clues. But looking at verse 38, which says, but Jesus said to them, "You don't know what you are asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I'm about to..." And actually, do you know something? I've just realized, I always count that, I read that wrong. There's an exclamation mark at the end of this. "You don't know what you are asking." Jesus wasn't being gentle, I don't think. "Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I'm about to drink? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering I must be baptized with?" So here's the question. What should have their response been to those statements? Yeah, no, we can't. That should have been their response. Think about it for a minute. Okay. But their response was, "Oh yes," they replied, "we are able." Sounds like another disciple. "Oh, Peter. Lord, no matter what, I don't care what comes my way, I will be with you even and until death." Little slave girl points him out as being a friend of Jesus. No, I don't know what you're talking about. Doing a runner. Cock crows. What is this teaching us about the three? So here's a question for you. What is your response to Jesus' statement, Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I'm about to drink? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering I must be baptized with? Now, this is a rhetorical question deliberately, because I want you to think about it. Now, some of you might be saying, I wouldn't ask Jesus to sit on his right or his left. I wouldn't dare or deign to do that. But actually, in reality, the fact we've come to know Jesus and we have eternal life and we know we're going to spend eternity with God, there is an element that we have actually said, Lord, we want to sit in glory with you. So, rhetorical question for you. What would, in reality, be your response to that statement from Jesus? Think about it for a minute, for yourself. Now, if your response is that of verse 39, oh yes, I am able to, I would like you now to reflect, how do you react to difficult situations in your life today? Do you walk into difficult situations with your face set like flint? I'm going in for this one. James and John are asking for places of honour. But it's honour that comes through suffering. Suffering for the gospel, for the good news, as Andy said earlier on. I can try and put this correctly and right. Bear with me a minute. We follow Jesus, amen? Amen. And we know that he is good. God is good. And all the time? Absolutely. There's no denying that. Problem is, we mix that up with our Western understanding of what goodness looks like. Okay? We mix it up. We mix it up with this, with the adverts and with the hedonistic lifestyle that says that everything should be great, you should always be happy. No trouble should ever come your way. We mistake Psalm 91. And so no trouble will ever come near your tent. Of course it does. And we take that view that life should be okay. And actually I say Western, but actually that's in all cultures. All cultures will recite things that say, you know, God works all things together for those who love him. Which means, in our heads at that point, oh, God's going to sort out all my little problems so I can have a nice, happy day today out and about. That's not what it means. It has a long-term view. We as Christians are, I hate to say this, but we are called to suffer for the gospel. The good news of Jesus Christ. Now note this phrasing, we are called to suffer for the good news. We are not called to suffer for the bad mistakes that we have made. If we've made a mistake, that's our fault, folks. You suffer the consequences, your fault. You don't sit there saying, I'm suffering here, oh, for Jesus, when it's your bad decision. Yeah? Or I'm trying to be pastorally incredibly sensitive here. Notice come on, Lord, help me. Help me out here. When junk comes your way, when things external, when illness comes or death comes or whatever else comes, and we sit there and some of us cry out and go, we shouldn't be suffering like this, we're Christians. Baloney. Absolute baloney. And we somehow then start thinking God loves us less. Where do you get that junk from? God is good.
All the time.
Doesn't mean that your life is to be super happy every moment. Yes, there are great moments. There are happy moments. There are fun moments. There's entertainment. There's things that you can enjoy. Absolutely. But it doesn't mean we coast through life thinking everything's going to be okay. That's not what we're called to do. We live in a crap, fallen, broken world. Yes, and I use the word crap. Deal with it. Okay? We live in a crap, fallen, broken world. There is junk. Do you know why? Because it's made up of us lot, humans. And we make bad decisions. We're loved by God. I meant every word of Psalm 139. In God's sight, you are pretty. You are beautiful. You are his masterpiece. But at times we mar it by our responses to situations. So junk comes our way. It doesn't mean that God doesn't love us any less. We try to avoid bad situations. I said this, I don't know if I said this last week, I know I said it in Ministry Network. We have become a risk-adverse nation. Yeah? Everything's about health and safety, health and hygiene. Yeah? Okay? Which, don't get me wrong, you know, the good aspects, that all of those things. What was the new one now? You can't go up a step ladder. A step ladder. For years, people have been going up step. Now you've got to be careful now. You've got to have somebody with you if you're up a step ladder on your own. You're not allowed to go up a step ladder on your own. Yeah, seriously. We got the letter through here about last year, 2 years ago. Not allowed to go up a step ladder. I mean, really? Yeah. You know, we won't ask Andy because. But you're not allowed to go up a step ladder. It's all right going, you can't go up a sheer ladder, you've got to have somebody foot it. But a step ladder that's designed for a person to go up on their own, unless somebody else is in the room with you, you can't go up. Now, I can understand that, because if they fall over and fall off, you need somebody there to give you medical services. So I get the point. But we go too far in all of that, in health and safety and health and health and hygiene. Well, I bet none of you follow it at home. The 3 second rule turns into the 3 minute rule, doesn't it? Right? See? Yeah, you don't want to come round to my house. That's all right, the burgers fell in the mud, it'll be fine. We'll get it off on the barbecue in a minute. Oh no, I wouldn't wreck it with water. No, I'll just have it. Is it a bit of crust? It would do you well good. We've got an immune system for a reason, everybody, do you know what I mean? That's just a good thing. Do you know something? If you don't poison your body, I'm not advocating poisoning, but the point is, your immune system only builds up more and more as it actually has to attack new and new viruses, new and new germs. That's the only reason the antibodies in your body are able to cope. Well, funny enough, that works with us Christians. The only reason we build up a sense of what the Holy Spirit can do through us and all that and what we can do for God is when we stick ourselves in situations we shouldn't be in, but God's put us there. But we're so risk adverse as a nation, we translate that into our Christian walk. Avoid all problems. Oh, hang on a minute. Now, in my workplace, we're not allowed to talk about religion because we don't want to offend anybody. That's a good rule. So let's not. So what we don't do is engage that maybe God will say, take a risk with this one. Nothing bad's going to happen. I'm going to protect you because you're doing it for the gospel. But even if you are suffering, you're suffering for the gospel, not for a bad decision. I didn't see Jesus be risk adverse, did you? I don't see the disciples being risk adverse, do you? And funny enough, when they were actually in trouble, when they were then having employment law put against them, they didn't just get fired, they would get flogged and hung up on a cross. Or stoned like Stephen. I don't see risk adverse, do you? It's a mentality I want us to battle against. Because the reason that Jesus was able to be a bit set like flint wasn't because he wasn't going to suffer really badly, which he was, but he saw the long-term goal. 3 days, which is very short term, but in 3 days, I'm going to rise again. He knew he was going to sit in glory with the Father. So he went through short-term serious suffering, but for a long-term, seriously great goal. We, and notice I include myself in this, we seem to want short-term entertainment, not having a long-term goal. And I preach and speak, yes, pastor, yes, but I'm also speaking as just like everybody else, a brother in Christ who hasn't had life nicely sailing through. I'm not saying going through right hassle right now, hear me very carefully, but do you know what I mean? We all go through stuff for the gospel. One of my very early experiences of knowing Jesus was the fact that bunch of friends would just walk away from me the minute I appeared. Apparently didn't want to hear about the word name Jesus. They thought I changed completely. Which on one level I had. It's not nice when your friends walk away. That's painful, especially somebody like me. I'm quite a relational person. Don't want to know any of you lot, but I'm quite a relational person. Joke, clearly. But I'm a relational person, and when that happens, that hurts. Or when you tell somebody something that's truth, and whether they like it or not, they're heading for a train crash, and you need to tell them that for the gospel's sake, for their sake, and for the wider sake, and yet they spurn you and don't want to talk to you and actually have a go at you. It hurts, but you have to do it. You can't not do it, because it's not about you. It's about the bigger picture. So, suffering in this sermon at the moment? Good, right. Moving on. I don't want to go into verses 41 into 45. It is blatantly obvious. We're all here to serve each other and serve the wider world, amen? You know, if one supposes wants to be a leader among you, trust me, I didn't want to suppose to be a leader among you, but my role is to serve. But I do also want to recognize that we're to be servants to all, not necessarily doormats to all. There is a distinct difference. The kingdom of God is about serving, not always being served. There are times and periods in our lives when we're in dark holes and we need others to come and serve us. And that's absolutely right and proper. But there is a point at some point in our life, we could carry on wallowing in the dark hole, but there is a point we know that we've actually got to get out of it and start serving others. That could be days, weeks, months, years. But we're here to serve each other. Amen? Amen? Okay, let's get on with Bartimaeus. The only healer, the only person to actually be named here in the book of Mark, of somebody in healing. There you go. So they'd reached Jericho, verse 46, and as Jesus and his disciples left town, a large crowd followed him, a blind beggar named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. By the way, that imagery of him sitting beside the road means he was marginalized, excluded. It's that imagery. No different from what Andy was talking about with the winter night shelter and the homeless. They are the marginalized, the sidelined, the put to one side. When Bartimaeus heard that Jesus of Nazareth was nearby, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." "Be quiet," many of the people yelled at him. But he only shouted louder, "Son of David, have mercy on me." When Jesus heard him, he stopped and said, "Tell him to come here." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up," they said. "Come on, he's calling you." Bartimaeus threw aside his coat, jumped up and came to Jesus. I just want to take just a sideline on that for a minute. So there you go, Bartimaeus sidelined. Everybody's telling him, "Shut up, be quiet. Don't bother this great teacher, you outcast, you've got nothing to do with us." The minute Jesus turned around and said, no, get him to come here. "Oh, cheer up, oh, come on, you're in with us now because Jesus wants you in." But it takes Jesus to say, no, this person's really important. I want a personal one-to-one with them. And so everybody flips. Oh, you're acceptable now because Jesus wants you. Come on then. Do you get the point? And how does that work for us, that the people that we sideline and we marginalise? And it could be that we sideline and marginalise somebody who's from another nation that we don't like because some reason we're not meant to. And then they start coming to the church and you start thinking, don't want them being involved. But then all of a sudden you see them being baptised. Oh, come on in. And actually, a lot earlier, we should have gone, "Come on in. Jesus wants to know you. I want to know you." Sidelined, marginalised. So, then Jesus asked him the question in verse 51. "What do you want me to do for you?" By the way, that's very similar to the question of verse 36. What is your request that John and James, that he asks of them? "My rabbi," the blind man said, "I want to see." And Jesus said to him, "Go, for your faith has healed you." Instantly, the man could see, and he followed Jesus down the road. Not actually an excellent translation, I would suggest, at the end there. It really should be, "And he followed Jesus on the way." Which then, when you pick up that imagery, you get the imagery of Jesus saying, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So actually, it's Bartimaeus and Mark showing us that actually Bartimaeus then follows Jesus on the way to suffering, into discipleship. Which is a stark contrast from James and John. And let's just look at those stark contrasts. I don't want to talk about the healing and all that, that's obvious. That's not the point of this story. The point of this story here is that when Jesus asked the questions of both sides, James and John and Bartimaeus, "What do you want me to do for you?" James and John's are, "Give us places of honour without the suffering." Bartimaeus is, "Give me sight," i.e. make me whole. James and John are whole. What they want is glory. So much more. Bartimaeus wants wholeness and healing and then is quite happy to follow Jesus on the way to suffering. Now, I was going to put up a BBC clip as I was preparing today's sermon, but it's on. Can't connect to the internet. Anyway, on the BBC, if you go to the BBC news this week, they were doing, and I couldn't believe it, I was putting this together, I found it in, just clicking, and there it was, it popped up on the news sideline thing. And it's a history looking back at some missionaries, and it's the daughter of one of the missionaries who's now sort of retired age, looking back in the 50s when her father and some other male missionaries flew into a remote, I'm trying to remember it all, I was relying upon the clip working, into a remote jungle area to a tribe that is completely, really unaware of outside the world, out the outside world. This is somewhere in the 50s, if my memory serves correctly, they did this. And as they were flying, and they knew that they were going to go into this tribe, they knew about this tribe from somebody else, and they were flying, and then she was recounting the journal of her father, who said, and then we saw the man from this tribe, I can't remember the name of the tribe, but anyway, waving to them, like beckoning them to come down. So I thought, oh, great, well, that's a signal from God then. Let's land. This is of God. So they land, they camp for a bit on a strip of beach, and eventually a man and two women come along and start touching the plane, and you see the imagery, they've got photography of this happening. And then they say, this is great, we start gelling, we start getting along, and the village people start to know them, but then something in the village people's heads was very suspicious. And then one, I think it was a Sunday afternoon, about 3 o'clock, 10 of the men from the village came and speared every single one of them, these missionaries, to death. And I thought, well, there's an image of suffering for the gospel. Oh, it goes on from that. A couple of years later, eventually what then happens is for two women from that village leave that village because of the violence that's happening in the village, meet up with the widow of the man and I think the sister of one of the other men, and the little daughter, get to know them. They get them to come back to the village, and this daughter, who's only a little girl at the time, remembers then actually meeting the 10 men that were part that killed her dad. But she remembers never being frightened of them, found them to be funny, they got along with the mum. Guess what? The reason they'd gone there is because the two women from the village wanted them to come and give the gospel to their own village and to bring Christ into it. And this woman in the story says, you know, I really wished my dad hadn't been killed. Strange that. I really would like to have known him, but don't feel any adversity against them. But notice what I mean about suffering for the gospel. It is a bigger picture than you and me. I really encourage you, I've not done the story, the best rendition. It's about 4 minutes long. Go to the BBC website, see if you can tag away and find it. Or if you want to, email me. I can send you the link that I've got currently, but I can't seem to load it up onto that. It's well worth seeing. So upon that point, my question was then going to be, well, let's look at ourselves for a minute. Why do we follow Jesus? Are we willing to suffer for him? Are we willing to actually go the whole hog and die for him when it is required? Now, normally, beautifully, we sort of nicely complete this moment, say, well, I can't see that happening here in England. Don't worry. We won't really have to worry about dying for the gospel in England. Actually, that's baloney. The chances are slimish, but nonetheless, are we comforted by that fact? And then that makes us less and less willing to suffer? Are we, as brothers and sisters in Christ following after God, become risk adverse in our walk with him? So I ask the question again, and I want you to reflect. We're finishing now. And this is one of those real deep questions that's going to yank, as it yanked me apart. You know, when I put sermons together, you know, it's not I just put this together and great, I'm just going to preach this out and I've done with it. I have to reflect as well. Do I believe this? Is this going to change my life? Am I going to think about this as well? So here's the question for you. Are you truly willing to suffer for the gospel? And it's not just about death. That could mean being mocked, spat on, flogged. That could mean being fired from your job. That could mean losing all your comfort factors, your possessions. Just want you to close your eyes now with God and ask and reflect with him. And you've got a good 3 minutes. Really engage with God right now. Lord, Heavenly Father, I ask in this most challenging of teaching this morning. You help us to be people who, in the light of your goodness, in the light of your grace, in the light of your love for us, to be people who examine ourselves in the area of suffering for the gospel. Lord, I pray for all of us. Help us to be people who speak up when it's going to hurt. To be quiet when it's going to be hurt. To be people who are no longer risk averse, but are risk takers. People who, like you, Jesus, can set their faces like flint and march and lead into suffering. Because it's for your kingdom, your glory, and for those around who do not yet know you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.